Good evening. I just arrived from LA an hour ago. Baruch Hashem worked out beautiful to get here on time. Just one announcement. We will have a lecture next Monday, and then we go on 3 weeks break, which I'm going to Israel. So we have next Monday we have a shiur, and then 3 Mondays no shiur. We'll be back on that Tuesday, 3 weeks later, in Brooklyn. As you know, last week we spoke about Sefer Shmot. We started Sefer Shmot. We already spoke about Shmot, Vayera, the seven first plagues as they took place, the story of the Jewish nation and Paro. If you remember, last year we discussed the message that we learned from Paro. It's a very important message for life, that the Rambam said that sometimes a person get to a situation that Hashem already take away his bechira, take away his free choice, free will. Meaning, you had a free will up to a certain point, and once you took advantage, you didn't take it serious, you had another chance and another chance and another chance, and at that point Hashem say, you know what, you're not getting the point, and God forbid, he take you from the positive list and put you on the black list. It's actually, we have people around us in life that they are in a black list, that Hashem already took away their free will, but they continue to live. Another 5 years, another 10 years, even 20 years. They can live. They can have children, they can raise the children, they can, you know, eat, go on vacation, even learn Torah, even listen to lectures. But they're already in a black list. This is a very, very big risk. The Rambam says, ha'onesh ha'kashe biyoter la'adam, the worst punishment that a person can get. That Hashem is locking the gate of repentance. Hashem is locking the gate of repentance in his face. You know? The question is, how we can make sure not to go into that, chas v'shalom, not to get into that situation. You know? Person is, another year is passing by, another year is passing by. And a person gets another chance, and another chance, and another chance. What makes you think you're going to have chances forever? I don't remember in 24 years more tragedies and sicknesses in a Jewish nation like these days. And never been so bad. And it's only get worse, I promise you, unfortunately. Every month is worse than the month before. Every month. You don't deal with the public, so you may not see it so much. You may hear one or two cases in your family or friends or neighbors. So you don't really get the point. Every 20 minutes I get a message of someone else that got cancer. Every 20 minutes. Sometimes 10 in an hour. On the WhatsApp messages. Please pray for this, please. On top of it, add accidents, lots of car accidents. People become paralyzed. 18-year-old boy from Lakewood just got a message, his car flipped over. Talmid Yeshiva. Add on top of this, the divorce epidemic, the drug epidemic, the depression epidemic. So many young boys and girls are in depression. Depression. Deep depression. Don't want to do anything from their life. Age 27, 28, laying in bed all day, doing nothing. Taking sleeping pills. Smoking grass. Running away from reality. The situation never been so bad. Never. Maybe, I don't know, I don't know where it's going to go. what's going to be the end of it? We can see the midat adin, the judgment, becoming more and more strict. In Israel, you don't have beds in the hospitals anymore. No room. They put patients in the hallway. You ever see such thing? You go to a hospital and the hallway is full of beds. People are in the hallway. There's no room for them. Can't get a bed. They send people home to clear the bed for someone that is more dangerous situation. As a result of that, people die. They send them home. They're supposed to keep them in the hospital a week or two, but there's no room. So send them home and they die. The jails are packed. No room in jails. So they let prisoners go out. I told you that 2 weeks ago. 1,000 prisoners they released in Israel. Pedophile, rapist, drug dealers. They released them. There's no room in jail for them. Same thing in America. Same situation. No room in jail. They let a lot of people get out. These people come back right into crime. What do you think? One of them came out of jail. The next day, he stole a car in Israel and a police chase. His car flipped over and he died. Just came out of jail. They let him get, they released him. Even they release, to release, you want to release prisoners? Release prisoners that became religious, became people, learned Torah, that they worked on themselves. What are you releasing criminal monsters? You don't have room, take the religious people, send them home. They're not a threat to society. There's a lot of Baalei Teshuva in jail. You know, I told you, I go there, I speak. A lot of serious people. Why keeping them there? They made the crimes when they're secular. They grew up like goyim. They didn't know anything from their life. Now they became very religious. They're not going to do any crimes like they used to. Those are the ones you should let go. When you're letting go people that are still criminals, you know the next day they're going to come right back. And same thing, they released these 1,000 terrorists for this liberal soldier, Gilad Shalit. The biggest mistake in the history of Israel. All 1,000 terrorists went back into crime. They already killed more than 100 Israelis. Stupid government. No Torah, no brain. Brainless politicians. Since when a politician has to follow his heart? You have a country to run. You have to use your head. People crying. What can we do? Soldier, they came, the Arabs. He threw his gun on the floor. Take me. They didn't even try to fight. So now they took him in, was sitting playing sheshbesh with them, eating hummus with them. No problem. They didn't torture him. He was a lefty. They didn't hate him. It was okay, doing okay. Doesn't matter. Even if it was tzaddik esod olam, doesn't matter. What do we care? We care how many Jews are going to die. What's better, 1 or 100? If you have to choose 2 buttons, 100 Jews will die or 1? Which button you would choose? Obviously, you don't want anyone to die, but you have no choice. It's either this or that. It's obvious. Well, you send 1,000 Palestinian murderers back into the streets. What do you expect? In less than a week, they're going to kill already more than one soldier. And until now, they're making all the terror attacks. None of them left. You have to understand, Palestinians, even if one of them decide to leave terror, he have no choice. He must get back into it. It's like a mafia. You must get back. They threat your family. You're not gonna, you know what to do. You know how to shoot. You know how to make bombs. We need you. No, leave me alone. I wanna go to university, be a doctor. Be a doctor, we'll show you be a doctor. You're not going to do for us, we'll kill all your children. We'll kill your wife. We'll kill your parents. They kill their own people. On top of it, they give them very nice money. Well, they don't have a job there where they work. They give them $3,000, $4,000, $5,000 a month. So why wouldn't they be terrorists? Add on top of it that they would even do it for free because they hate us so much. So it's a guarantee. Guarantee. I don't understand why they lock them in. They must execute all of them immediately. Everyone they catch. and he has to do terror, immediately to execute him, quietly, without media. Right away, you were involved in terror attack. Quickly, death penalty, bury him inside pig leather, somewhere in the middle of nowhere. Take a video, publish it on WhatsApp, on Facebook, everywhere. Every one of you will kill our children, will put you inside a pig and bury you, and nobody will ever find you. These fools, they believe that if you get buried in the skin of a pig, you don't have a share to the world to come. And they're very worried because they're going to miss the 72 imaginable virgins that they promised them. You understand? So once they see once or twice you're going to bury them in a pig skin, nobody will do anything anymore. They won't take that risk. You understand? The politicians are, like I say, most of them are brainless. Totally brainless. A few normal ones that I speak to, and I give them some instructions and advice what to do, what to say, what laws to pass in the government. Sometimes it succeeds, sometimes it doesn't, because in Israel everything takes years. Bureaucracy, everything years. One committee and another committee and another committee. It's never end until it actually comes for vote. There's a lot of steps. We were about to do one very good thing, and now the government collapsed. That's it. There's election. Chaval. If the government wouldn't collapse, something good would happen. But no. We'll see what's going to be, Bezrat Hashem. Anyway, so one more thing we have to know, that if Hashem gives you an opportunity to be tzaddik when you're young, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, this is, you're still fragile. It's like a young baby. Before age 20, that's the best time to become religious. Because some of the punishment starts only from age 20. Not everything starts from 13. Especially today, I said in my Shabbaton in LA now, yesterday, I said there was 400 people there. I said to them, if it was up to me, I would change the age of bar mitzvah to 18. So what? So yes. 2,000 years ago, 13 years old boy was like at least 18 today, or maybe 20. Like people used to get married 13. Run a house, run a field, collect wheat, barley, take care of the cows, take care of the sheep, the chickens, go to the market, do business. Age 13 was a real man. Age 16, 17, he already had 2 kids. What's age 13 today? Baby that play Atari, what's the name of it? What is it? Xbox. Huh? Xbox, yes, that's the name, Xbox. Somebody like this is a man? Still a little kid. A froach. You know, that's what he is. But we are not reformed. We can't change any law in the Torah. 13 it is, that's it. You cannot play with the laws. But psychologically, of course, what's the question? So Hashem knows that little kids like these, 13, 14, they're not in a mental state to be judged like adults. Even though, according to the Torah, once you're 13, that's it. You're responsible for all your sins. But the Gemara even said that some of the sins, it starts from age 20, meaning the main serious punishment. So if a person becomes religious younger than 20, it's fantastic. It's almost like he never been secular. If once he's younger than 20, he become religious, he is going to have a lot of help from Hashem. 100% siyata dishmaya. He will just make the first step and Hashem will do the rest for him. As you can see, a lot of teenagers, they decide to get up, go to yeshiva, sometimes in Israel. A year later, they come back, you can recognize them. They went there almost goyim, they came back rabbanim. Can't believe it. In 1 year in Yerushalayim. Why? In this age, it's possible. Once you're 35, 40, it's a lot harder, especially if you have wife and children and business. It's a lot harder. So what happened? If you had a chance to become religious when you were a teenager and you turned it down, it doesn't mean it's the end of the story for you. You're going to have a few more chances in life. That's how it goes usually. Now, age 20, you had another chance. You still turned it down. If you would take it, you won't have 100% siyata dishmaya. Of course not. Only first time. You turned me down, second time you'll have less. You didn't take it, third time you'll have less. Fourth time you'll have less. Fifth time even less. Until when you finally decide to become religious when you're 50, it's almost impossible for you. You cannot sit 1 hour in a Torah class without falling asleep. You're getting old. You're not clear like you used to be when you're 20 or 15. If you come to shul and put tefillin and talit and listen to a little bit Dvar Torah 20, 15 minutes without falling asleep, that's a huge achievement. Then you have children and sometimes grandchildren. You have to run the show, you have to run. You're a slave of the family. In this kind of condition, it's a lot harder to become religious. Now add on top of it that usually when you already have a wife and children, not always they cooperate with you. You saw the light. You know how many thousands of times people came to me and say, I'm dying to become very religious, but my wife doesn't let. What am I going to do with my children? It's going to turn me away from my children. I have a 16 years old daughter. She's rebelling. She goes out with Arabs. She has earrings and tattoos. I'm going to tell her we keep Shabbat. What am I going to do? My son is like this. My other son is like that. My wife is like that. My wife is a liberal. She's a lefty. If she's going to find out I'm keeping Shabbat, she's going to divorce me right away. Take away all my money. Now there's no siyata dishmaya. Very little siyata dishmaya. Very little. Why? Where were you 20 years ago, 30 years ago, when I came and reached my arm to you? You turned me away, right? Every time you turn Hashem away, you're going to deal with the consequences later on. The world is not a picnic. Even though everyone lives in a dream and in illusion, and people run after the house in Great Neck and the Mercedes and all this show off, it's all baloney. In the end, people will pull their hair off when they stand in a trial, when they die. When they see what they burned their life on, they'll kill themselves. They'll be dead already. They'll say, wow, what a stupid person I was. Look what I have to deal with now. And the worst thing is that the biggest pain that people will have is that they heard me or other speakers that they listen to that warned them that that's going to be their end many times, and they didn't listen. And now when they see it's reality, imagine the pain. Imagine the pain. I remember I got one time a call from a friend of mine. He came to me for Shabbat once, then we became friendly. He told me it was in a different state. It's really an emergency. There is a girl from a Moroccan family. Her parents Israeli, traditional. Traditional. And not Shomer Shabbat. Mechalele Shabbat is like Goyim. As a traditional. Shulchan Aruch say, not me, the Jewish book of law. I did not write it. I wish I did, but I wasn't. It's written clearly, Mechalel Shabbat, Arehu kegoy lechol davar. It's 100% like a goy in the eyes of Hashem. No difference. Can't even bury him in a Jewish cemetery. Sometimes it's absurd that some of these Mechalel Shabbat call themselves traditional. Traditional? Shame on you, chatzuf. What traditional? Became more a goy than a Jew. Traditional. Your grandfather in Iran or Bukhara or Iraq or I don't know where would die not to be Mechalel Shabbat. He was traditional. He kept the tradition. What tradition you keep? Traditional. You kiss the mezuzah? I know goyim that kiss the mezuzah. What traditional about you? That you eat ashpolo? Huh? What traditional about you? That you eat Bukharian bread? Traditional means to keep the mitzvot, the tradition. That's what it means, traditional. So I got a call that there's a girl, she ran away from home, with a black guy, and she lives in a ghetto somewhere with the black people. She's a Jewish girl from Israeli background. And her parents are killing themselves because they don't know what's going to happen with her. She's going to get into drugs. It's in a ghetto over there. It's a lot of criminals in that place. Very dangerous place. And who knows what they're doing to her. Maybe they're taking advantage on her. She's a girl, little girl. She was, I don't know, 16, 17, 18 maybe. It's many, many years ago, this story. So they said, you're the only one that can talk to her, maybe open up her head, maybe it's you. I said, how am I going to get in touch with her? They don't even know where she is. There's only one girl that knows where she is, but she doesn't want to tell. But she agreed to send her the messages. Like whatever the parents or anyone sent, she goes and tells her, but she refused to tell where she is. So I said, organize a big lecture by her uncle, invite a lot of people, and tell her to come only for a few minutes. Just to come for a few minutes, and I want to talk to her. It worked. She agreed to come. She came. I came upstairs to the house. It was a big house. I spoke to her for 10, 15 minutes. Literally, I begged her. I told her, now we can save you. Now. She had earring, big gold earring like the black people. Tons of grease on her hair, earring in the nose, and she was speaking 100% like a black person. You would never know, she's a Jewish girl. No, nothing. If I would see her on the street and talk to her, or in a store, in a million years, I would never believe such thing. And she, mamash, I said, wow, how this Jewish girl became like a goya like this? So I begged her, now we can save you. We'll take you to Monsi, we'll save you. No, I know, you're right. Believe me, every night before I go to sleep, I cry. So now we can save you. No one would know where you are. He won't know where you are. This monster she lived with. He won't know. He won't find you. No, not yet. I'm going to do it, but not now. So I told her, what do you mean not now? Next time you speak to me, maybe you'll be pregnant already. And that's exactly what happened. 2 months later, I got a message, she became pregnant. Now, when he found out she's pregnant, he threw her like a dog to the street. What does he need her? He's taking advantage on this stupid girl. Naive. Threw her to the street like a dog. So she can't go back home, and she can't be with him. So who she came for help? To us, to me and my friend. So he said, okay, we'll take you now. Now she's pregnant. What are we going to do with her now? Put her by a Jewish family in Monsi. I had one friend that still lived in Monsi back then in time. I said, he's the only person in the world that in a short notice will agree to take a stranger into his house that look 100% like a goya, even though he has religious children and this. How many people would agree? And we're talking late at night. Till we get there, it's hours of driving. It's not in New York. To go get her. I called him up. I said, listen, it's an emergency. Pikuach nefesh. He said to me, do I have a choice? I said, no. So bring her. I saw his face when he opened the door and he saw her. He almost fainted. You don't understand how she looked. You know what it needs? She spilled probably a bottle of grease on her hair. You know how, I don't know how they do. They put grease on the face. I don't know what's this grease. But this is how it looked. All kinds of flowers, I don't know. A big earring like this, the whole face. And no, an accent, like African she sound. No one would, I'm telling you, and there's religious kids, girls, boys. 3 days I was afraid to show my face because I used to go to him every day in lunch break from the yeshiva. We sit, we talk, we drink coffee, we go over the learning. 3 days I did not show up. I could not show my face from embarrassment. Like they say in Israel, I threw a serious case on him. Zarakti alav tik tik. 3 days I saw, I'm not getting any calls, no complaint, no nothing. I said, okay, I'm curious to see what happened. I came there, they opened the door. As soon as they opened the door, she was in the kitchen, in front of the door, washing dishes. But this time, with the scared, straight hair, no grease, no earring. Even she started to speak like a Jewish girl. This whole accent thing, it's all a show. It's all a bluff. This is the effect that the world has on our children. So she became very religious, Baruch Hashem, by my friend's house, with his wife, with him, the wonderful people. She got the point. But now she's pregnant. What are we going to do now? Found her a family that are willing to adopt the kid, but in one condition, that the kid will be white. Because if he will be black, everyone will know he's a goy. Came from a goy. He's a Jew. No matter what, he's a Jew. But came from a goy. The family don't want. If we are white parents, we don't want a black kid. Because they know it's not our son. We want to adopt a kid that people think it's our child. Which, that's the way the world is. You can do the same thing by black parents. They would rather adopt a black kid that looks like their own biological son. So what happened? 9 months, everyone was praying that Hashem will make a white kid, that the family will adopt them, because the life of this girl is basically over. Who's going to marry her with a kid? 16, 17 years old kid. You know how difficult it is to get married as it is. The baby was born Temani. Half enough. Temani, okay, Temani is Pseder. You can say the father is Temani, no problem. But what do you think happened when the baby was born? She did not want to give it. I can't give the child. Because there's a big connection between a woman and a child. She kept him. And she married a Baal Tshuva. And they had another 5 or 6 or 7 kids. And this Baal Tshuva became a big Rebbe. You know what Rebbe means? A real big Rebbe. People standing on lines online all day to speak to him. They write requests, bringing checks. That's what happened. Who would ever believe that this story will end like this? And that boy became Hasidish. Speaks Yiddish. And do you think that his biological father ever cared where he is? Never. It's unbelievable that a person brings a child to the world who doesn't even care about it. Throw the mother, get out of here. He knows he has some kid somewhere. Doesn't care about it. Happens a lot to the Hollywood stars. They go to women. They give them some money. Get out of here. But what about the child? It's your child. I don't want anything to do with him. Sign here. Here's your money. Don't ever bother me. Because people are selfish. All they care about is themselves. They don't care about anybody else. Once you're such a selfish person, you care about your children? You don't care. The Torah said that someone that marries his daughter to an old man, it's like making her a prostitute. Why? What kind of a father will do such thing to his daughter? She's 14, 15, 16, like they used to get married in the old days. You get her a guy 60 years old. Muhammad, I think, was 70, he married a little girl. Once I read an article. That's why in the internet some people called him pedophile. Your grandfather and you marry a little girl like this? Hard to believe things that people used to do. Even today, by the way. Today there's a lot of older people marry very young people. Used to be a very famous singer in Israel. He was 50-something and married a girl, 19. Very famous. Of course that marriage did not last. 2, 3, 4 years later, they got divorced. People are selfish. They only think about themselves. What do you think, drug addicts, they're not selfish? They're also selfish. If they care about other people, their parents, their brothers, their sisters, so many people suffer because of them, they wouldn't do what they do. With all the desire. But it's a part of selfishness. Being selfish is that you don't care that everyone else suffers. You don't care. Your parents cry, you don't care. Your brothers and sisters, shidduchim, get destroyed, you don't care. Your boss is suffering, you don't care. Your children are suffering, you don't care. Maybe you care a little bit, but not enough. So remember, Rabotai, it gets to a point that once you get to that point, that's it. There is no more help from Hashem to become religious. No more help. And you know what the problem is? That if you don't have help from Hashem to become religious, if you don't have help from Hashem even to bang a nail or a screw to the wall, you cannot do it. Some people think, big deal, what's to I take a nail and bang it 3 times and it goes into the wall. What's the big deal? I want to hang a picture. What's the big deal? No, you need Hashem for it. 1 second Hashem remove his supervision from you, you bang your finger and break it. And 1 year you suffer. Can't even go to the bathroom. Can't even clean yourself. Cannot write. Cannot type. Even to drive you can. Finger is broken. Hurts. You know how much suffering? If Hashem remove his supervision and siyata dishmaya from you for 1 second, you cannot survive. You can't survive. People think, oh, I'm living because it's the law of nature. Ma pitom. You're only living because Hashem is reviving you every second. Your entire body that holds the soul, your body looks 6 feet. 6 feet, 200 pounds. This image of you, do you really have a body? What do you think? Do you really have a body or it's all an illusion? There's really no body. This body that you see, it's not even a dot. You know, take a pencil, make a very small dot on the paper. Your body is smaller than this dot. So how do you see such a big image? Because the atoms of the physics, the atoms, the movement of the atoms is so fast that it moves so fast that it creates an illusion of material. The whole world is the size of a gum. The whole world. You cannot imagine the speed of the atoms. They move so fast that it gives an illusion that there is an earth. It's unbelievable. I know what I say now, it sounds to you like Chinese. I know that. When I read about it, like a fan. When I read about it for the first time, I had to read it 3 or 4 times to make sure I'm not dreaming. For the first time when I read about it in a book of physics, that if you see a building, it's really not a building. It's the movement of the atom who creates it. And what happens if you take a piece of wood and you cut it in the middle? Now you have 2 pieces that the atoms are moved. If it was 3 feet and you cut it in the middle, now it's 1.5 and 1.5. So the atoms are moving in 2 different places. This piece of wood here and this piece of wood, and it constantly moves. And you put it and you connect something on top of it. It's unbelievable how Hashem made his world. So your entire body is an illusion. If Hashem removes his supervision from the movement of the atom in your body, who moves the atom? Where the energy comes from? Nothing is moving without energy. Can't move. I'll tell you why. When a fan turns around very fast, can you go through it with your finger? You can only go through it if it goes very slow. So you have a second to push your finger in and out. But if it goes so fast, it looks like a full circle. You put your finger in, you cut it. Or you get rejected. So you see that you have actually 4 arms, the shape of a cross, but it's really a full circle. Because of the movement, it becomes a full circle. So you cannot breathe a second without Hashem. In the Shabbaton that I was now in L.A., there was one Israeli woman that she was moments from dying. Not only, she's not even old, she's in her 40s. She was moments from dying. Her lung collapsed. Lung. 1 day before it was too late for her, they called her that they found her alone. they did a transplant of a lung and saved their life. She has a lung of someone that died. They took it from that person. How Hashem made some goy die, that they'll take the loan from that goy and put it by her and save her life, and now she became religious. How the world runs. So I told her, you, more than anyone, have to keep the word of the Pasuk, Kol HaNeshama Te'ale Elia Alleluia. For every neshima and neshima, Chazal say. For every breath you take, you have to praise Hashem. We take it for granted that we breathe. She was already dead. She couldn't breathe. So now she got new lung. She's able to breathe. I say, every breath you take, you have to think, thank you, Hashem. Thank you, Hashem. Thank you, Hashem. All your life. Really, that's what you should do. Obviously, you can't do that, but at least to understand that that's your obligation. Vayomer Hashem el Moshe, bo el paro. כי אני אכבדתי את ליבו. I make his heart stiff, stubborn. I block his will, free will. ואפשר, this I'm reading it to you, רמב״ם, הלכות תשובה, פרק ו', הלכה ג'. אפשר שחטא אדם חטא גדול. It's possible that a person will make a very big sin. Very big sin. As Shetish, for instance, went with a married woman, had gay activity, murdered someone. That scene turned everything around to the negative side. Oh, many small sins, but massive amount of sins, non-stop. 1, 2, 3, 4, all day like this, for months, for years. Until that HaKadosh Baruch Hu will block his way from doing tshuva. Shemoniim imenu ha-tshuva. Ve'en manichim lo lashuv mirish'o. Hashem does not let you become tzaddik. Not anymore. Too late for you, buddy. Too late for you. Kedei sheyamut, that he should die, ve'yovad bechet'o, and will be destroyed because of his sin. Sin or sins. Lefichach, therefore, it's written in the Torah, Vani achazek et lev paro. Paro could have released you up to the sixth plague. From now on, it's over. Now it's payback time. Now we're paying him now, and to his people. עד שנפרע ממנו, לפיכך חיזק הקדוש ברוך הוא את ליבו. Hashem made his heart stiff. ולמה היה שולח לו ביד משה ואומר, שלח ועשה תשובה. So why Hashem bothered to continue up to the 10th time to still tell him, release them, release. כדי להודיע לבאי עולם, to inform the people of the world and those who will come later in history, later on, to learn from this. שכיוון שמונע הקדוש ברוך הוא התשובה לחוטא, השם prevented the repentance from a sinner, אינו יכול לשוב, he cannot do תשובה anymore. That's it, it's over. אלא ימות ברשעו, he will die because of his wicked way. רמב״ם, Laws of Repentance, Chapter 6, Provision 3. Here you see, you have the source. Don't say, I say it. Understand? So if someone comes and say to you, nonsense. Everybody can do tshuva. Hashem accept everyone. Even a minute before he died. It's not always true. Sometimes it's true. Sometimes it's not true. And you won't be able to. Now the question is, how do we know that we are not in this black list? Maybe we are also in this list. Imagine this, Chas v'Shalom. How do we know? Maybe Hashem already put us in that list. That's it. Cannot do tshuva. How do we know? The answer, there's really no way to know. For sure, there's no way to know. The only way to know is if you see that you're becoming better in religion. So you are doing tshuva. Oh, Baruch Hashem, so Hashem did not erase me yet. Sometimes you have a brother. No matter what he hears, he does not change. Does not change. So how can it be? What is this guy? Is a monster? What is he? How can he be so ungrateful? How can he see the proofs and ignore it? How can he destroy his future like this? It's not in his hand, my friend. He's already in a list that he doesn't have a free will. We have another rule. בדרך שאדם רוצה ללך, מוליכים אותו. In a way that Hashem chooses to walk, Hashem walk you through. You want to walk through righteousness, Hashem will help you. You want to be a drug dealer, who helps you to sell drugs, to kill children? Who gives you success? Who help you to be able to find the drugs from Mexico and bring it to New York and sell it to kids and kill them? Who gives you air while you are doing this crime? You breathe, no? Who gives you the breath? Hashem, why? He sees that you are murdering children now. Innocent children, 14, 15, you're murdering them. Why? Hashem does not interfere with the free will of a person unless he erases him. Oh, it's too late already. Whatever you choose to do, Hashem helps you to do. You buy a gun, you go, you kill someone. If this person deserves to die, Hashem allow you to do it, and later he's going to punish you for that. You break Shabbat. Who gives you the mind to drive? Who helps you to find the direction? Who helps you to see? Who helps you to breathe? Who make your brain function when you drive in the middle of Shabbat? Who help you to steal? To steal, you need to be clever. You cannot be stupid. You steal, you cheat people, you cheat customers, you cheat competitors, you cheat your suppliers, you cheat the whole world. Who gave you these sneaky ideas? Who make you think? Who function your brain when you have all these bad ideas? Hashem, 100%. Same way Hashem helped the tzaddik to learn Gemara and understand and become tzaddik and become better and better, he helped the monster to become a bigger monster. He has to. Otherwise, there's no test. If Hashem will only help the righteous and the wicked will die, nobody will be wicked. Why are you Shomer Shabbat? I try not to be Shomer Shabbat. I couldn't breathe. Hashem took away my bread. So I have to be Shomer Shabbat. Big deal. He deserves a reward. Take one secular person who hates Torah. Tell him, if this Shabbat you're not going to keep, from the first sin you do on Shabbat, you won't be able to breathe. Shabbat comes, he doesn't take you for serious. Right away he lit a cigarette. Oh, I can't breathe. Please, please. Okay, give me another chance. Okay, here. Another chance. That's it. He'll never break Shabbat for the rest of his life. Not because he loves Hashem or because it's the truth. Just doesn't want to choke. Doesn't matter. Take an Arab terrorist. Take away his breath. He will also be Shomer Shabbat. That's defeat the purpose of the creation. The purpose of the creation is to be in a place of a test. What else? We learn that many people, when they get problems in life, how they look at the problems. I want to ask you, let's be honest. You just got into an accident, $2,000 damage. $2,000 damage, you have to waste now a day, go to the collision place, insurance, this, all this headache. How do you look at it? Ay, ay, ay. Why did I live in a rainy day? Stupid rain made me slid like this and go into an accident. Oh, you scream at the guy. Don't you have eyes in your head? You fool. Look what you did. En lecha enayim barosh? You don't have eyes in your head? How many people right away, first thought is, wow, Hashem, I'm sorry, what did I do? that you gave me this punishment. He immediately begin to think, why did I get a $2,000 loss now? Maybe this, maybe with a customer, maybe the customer wanted to return something and I told him no, even though my policy say yes. Maybe I sold something not real. Maybe I do this, maybe I do. He begin to think. How many people do cheshbon nefesh when something bad happened to them? How many people get a call from their wife that their kid fell and broke their hand in school and you need to take him to hospital? And the first thing they think, wow, Hashem, what did I do that you're doing this to me? How many people look at everything that happened to them that Hashem is doing it? Not nature, not goyim, not people, not animals, nothing. None of them exist for me. It's me and Hashem. How many? Talmidei Chachamim, those who learn in yeshiva, yes. But ordinary religious people, they don't look at this. Hashem, Hashem. You know what the problem is? I'll tell you what the problem. It's written in the Torah, Ve'alachtem imi bakeri. If you will interact with me by saying it's random, coincidence, mikre, mikre, it happened, accident, accident. In Judaism, there's no such word. There's no such thing, accident. Only in secular language you have the word accident. There's no such thing, accident. Accident means that something was not supposed to happen and it happened by mistake. There's no such thing. There's not one transaction in the life of a Jewish person that is an accident. There's no such thing. Someone stole from you, it's not an accident. The bank did something to you, it's not an accident. You fell, you slid, there was banana on the floor, the peel, you didn't see it, you fell, you broke your head. No accident. One thief mugged you on the street with a gun. It's no accident. There's no such thing, accident. Why did I have to go there? Why? You worry, why did you go there? Worry what got you to get this punishment. Today, not only people don't think I'm being punished for something, almost nobody thinks like that. People even get angry when they listen to a speaker that say that everything we have is from Hashem. They get angry. I'm talking religious people. Why are you saying that it's from Hashem? Who told you? The Torah told me. Is that good enough for you? Mr. Apikores with a beautiful beard? The Torah told me. Where? Here. Im tilchu imi bekeri. Keri means mikre. If you will interact with me by saying, oh, bad luck, coincidence, accident, words like this, I'm going to return to you what you deserve. What does it mean? I will add more to your punishment. Midah keneged midah. Oh yeah, accident? Let me give you just another one right now. We learn, if a person think that the problems that comes to him are random and are coincidence, mikre, gorem leatzmo tzarot nosafot, bring more problems to his life. You understand, Rabotai? All these modern fake religious people, if you tell them what happened to you is because of this or because of that, do you check this? Maybe because of that, maybe that. Maybe, we don't know for sure. Maybe. How angry they get. If you tell them, wow. If you remember 3 years ago, 4 years ago, I put a picture in my Facebook page of the temples of the big idols in Nepal. Remember there was an earthquake in Nepal? Hundreds of big statues that the goyim bow down to the statue, which is against the 7 law of Noah. It's a death penalty for the goyim to worship idols. So I put a picture in my Facebook page of all the statues are broken. And I wrote one sentence. all the idols are now broken. I didn't say, wow, great that all the idol worshippers died. None of this. I did not write they deserve it. I did not write we're happy that they got what they deserve. Nothing like that. All I wrote is one sentence. What is it? All the idols are now broken, which is an obligation from the Torah to be happy. We have a bracha. Baruch Oker Avodah Zara Me'olamo. Chazal make a bracha. Just like you make a bracha to put tefillin, just when you make a bracha to shake lulav, just when you make a bracha to eat matzah, all these brachot that Chazal made, there's one more bracha. Bless you, God, that destroy the idols from your world. That means you have to make bracha to Hashem, to praise Hashem for it, to be happy about it. You had to see all the liberal Jews, how they went crazy. I'm talking religious liberal Jews. They call today modern Orthodox. You had to see their comments, how crazy they went. To the point that one of them came to my wife, tell your husband, shame on him. What? She didn't even know what she wants. What's the problem? He's happy that the temple in Nepal is destroyed? She said, what is she talking about? Dogs like to bark. You don't have to pay attention for everyone that bark. These people, you know how many problems they bring to themselves by the way they talk? By the way they think? Even Goyim don't think like this. You won't find an Arab that think that what happened to me is an accident. I went to buy a tree from an Arab in Israel. He has a nursery, you know, they sell trees. I say to him, how do I know you will really bring the tree? I'm going back to America. I won't be here. So he said to me, Yosef, don't you and me know that the Parnassah comes from Hashem? You think I'm going to dare to steal from you? If I deserve it, he will give it to me. If not, well, it's not going to be mine. Delivered. Arab. 2 minutes later in front of me, went on the floor and started to pray. There's no such thing. You tell Arab, your kids died. They praise God. He gave me the kid. He took you the kid. They don't say, oh, bad luck. I don't deserve it. But they're better than you. What's going on here? How can it be such thing? People with yarmulke get angry when things happen to them. We don't deserve it. Yeah. Huh? Ayin hara doesn't come to you if you're innocent. Ayin hara is that the Satan just come to Hashem and say, look, even people know he doesn't deserve to get what he got. So it speeds the problem. Speeds. If a person is tzaddik, innocent, why is going to, ayin hara can touch him? Why is going to die if he's innocent? The whole concept of ayin hara, in my opinion, one of the mistakes that the rabbi do, include myself, is even speaking about it. It's a mistake to speak about it. It's written in a Gemara, so you cannot deny it. But I think that by speaking about it, you divert the attention of the public from the main reason to the secondary reason. Meaning people come, Rabbi, I need to talk to you. What? I have a lot of problems in my life. Where can I get the ayin hara away from me? Are you Shomer Shabbat? No, Rabbi. Your kids go to yeshiva? No, public school. You eat kosher? Sometimes. You go to the mikveh? No. Your husband put tefillin? In his bar mitzvah, I think he did. You give tzedakah? No. Anything you do? Not really. Worry about ayin hara. You understand what's going on here? She's worried about Ayin Hara. Every second she lives is a miracle. Because according to Torah, she should have already died 5 million times already. 5 million times. Every Chilul Shabbat, death penalty. Every this, every that. 5 million times she should have died already. She worried about Ayin Hara. That's the problem. Rabbi, I think someone put kishuf on me. Witchcraft. Witchcraft. Wow. From all the people in the world, they need to put witchcraft on you. What are you, Moshe Rabbeinu? Who are you? People don't want to take responsibility. I have a friend, he's a sofer in Monsi. People bring him the mezuzot to check. He said, why are you bringing me the mezuzot to check? You suspect something went wrong? No, Rabbi, you have to check. We have a lot of problems recently. My husband lost his job. My mother is sick. My son is this. So what does he say to them? The mezuzot are kosher. Don't worry. How do you know? He didn't check them. 90% of the mezuzot are kosher. Don't count on it. So what is it? Did you check yourself? Of course not. If we can find one mezuzah that is not kosher and replace it for 70, 80 bucks and think that the problem now is resolved, that's the best, that's the easiest way out. Pay 100 bucks and you're out of it. How many people take themselves to check? They come to the rabbi, check me out. This is what I do, this is what I do not do. Check me out. Tell me what's right, what's wrong. If the rabbi tell you something you do wrong, you right away go to a different shul. What happened, Moshe? Why you started to go to that shul over there 10 blocks away? Something happened? I don't like this rabbi. Why? Yes, chutzpah. Why chutzpah? He told me why I park the car in front of the shul. I should park it one block away when I come on Shabbat. That's enough for him to go somewhere else. So, if a person say what happened to me is random and coincidence, immediately Hashem sends him new problems. Coincidence? You will see coincidence. This is what Moshe informed Paro, that for two things, the plagues will come to him. A, that he does not send the Jewish people, and two, for saying that the plagues is not the hand of Hashem. Two reasons, not one. One, that he does not let them go. He's supposed to let them go. But second is that he denied that it's the hand of Hashem and he brings his Chartumim to do the same magic. You understand what's going on here, Rabotai? Come on, we have to be careful. We have to be really careful. Because the way you react to your problems, bring more problems. Bring more problems. How many people knew that? How many people here know that if you look at something as a natural disaster, as a natural tragedy, as a natural cause, that right away Hashem will send you another problem right away, the next day, the next week. How many people know it? Raise their hand. At least you're honest. Nobody knew that. Nobody knows it. And even people who knew it forgot about it. That's why they keep blaming nature. How many times we blame the Arabs for our problems? Huh? Don't we speak, the Arab do this, the Arab like this, the Arab like this? We all do. All of us, no exception. What Arabs? Arab and the tree, it's the same thing. Arab and the lion is the same thing. The Arab and the bear is the same thing. The Arab and the snake. Hashem needs the Arab. He can use the snake to kill you. Or the bear. Or the dog. How many times dogs ate their own owners and killed them? Amstaff dogs. After 20 years, they took care of them. When the time comes, that's what happens. This is the stick in the hand of Hashem. In this parasha, you know, today was Rosh Chodesh. We started Chodesh Shvat. This year we have two Adar. It's a leap year. Adar Aleph, Adar Bet. Why? Because if we wouldn't have Adar Bet, Pesach would fall around March, which is cold in Israel. So they have to postpone it to the second half of April, something like this, when it's already spring and warm. The Torah, in this coming parasha, HaChodesh HaZeh Lachem Rosh Chodashim. It's talking about Nisan, the month of Nisan. This month of Nisan, to you, is the beginning of the year. The sages, the Chazal, the Chachamim, and Rashi follows them. They said that this pasuk is a very important, critical verse in the Torah. Very important. They were wondering why the Torah did not start with this verse. Rashi say, based on what the Chachamim say, that the Torah should have really start with that pasuk. Achodesh hazeh lachem rosh chodashim, rishon hu lachem lechodshei hashana. Because why? Why? Why the Torah should have started with this mitzvah? Because that's the first mitzvah that the Jewish nation was commanded. Achodesh hazeh lachem rosh chodashim. But it's really not the first mitzvah. There are two mitzvot that came before that. Which one? Who knows? Brit Mila and Gida Nashe. Brit Mila and Gida Nashe. No, I'm talking the Torah, in the Torah. Brit Mila and Gida Nashe. Well, 200 of the mitzvot come from Sefer Dvarim. Many of the mitzvot come from Sefer Vayikra. Vayikra, Bamidbar, Dvarim, that's almost all the mitzvot. In Bereshit, you only have three mitzvot. That's it. In the whole book of Bereshit. Why it's so important, this verse? This verse is to teach us when the Beit Din decide that it's Rosh Chodesh, right? It goes based on the words, not based on reality. Even the Beit Din make mistake. They decided that Rosh Chodesh is today when it was supposed to be tomorrow or the other way around. Afilu mezidim, afilu shogegim, afilu mutim, even a mistake. We count from that day, and that's when you celebrate the holidays. Based on that mistake, everyone will eat on Yom Kippur. And everyone will fast the next day. Why? The Chachamim decided that's the reality. This is the power of the Chachamim. Hashem gave the Chachamim a power to decide the date, to decide the calendar, to decide when you're going to fast and when you're going to do Korban Pesach. The Torah is trying to explain the nation that HaKadosh Baruch Hu, what the commandments that Hashem commands us to do, is not lo b'shamayimi. It's not unreachable. Hashem is perfect with or without us. All the mitzvot are for our own benefits. He does not need anything from us. How do we learn it? Who knows where in the Tanakh it's written? That nothing of what we do change Hashem even a bit. Nothing. I give you an example. Sometimes a person is sick. You come, you take care of him, you make him cure. So now, thanks to you, he's better. So we can affect people to be better or to be worse. We can make them paralyzed. We can kill them. We can make them lose a part of their body. So we can improve, we can upgrade or downgrade the life of people. Even by words, you can say something to someone or abuse him verbally and he loses all his confidence and he has now low self-esteem, and as a result of that he went to horrible drugs and his life is over. You can affect a person by the way you talk to him. You can destroy his life. How many people hate religion because of the way their parents spoke to them when they grew up? They don't want to hear about it. It's not, they have no problem with Hashem or with the commandments of the Torah. They know very well that Torah is divine. Very well they know. They don't want to even hear it. They can't look at a rabbi. Why? They were abused in yeshivot. They made fun of them. They put them down. They don't want to even think going back to those days. We're going to have to pay the price for the mistakes we did. And we're already paying. Why? The biggest punishment of a person in life is what? That his child goes off the derech. His child was religious, righteous, and became not. Became secular. It's written in the Gemara that something like this is worse than Gog u'Magog. Gog u'Magog will destroy 2/3 of the world. 5 billion people will die. Rivers of blood. It will take years to bury all the bodies. It's going to be an epidemic. The world will be in a worse situation it's ever been in the time of Gog u'Magog. As the prophet Zachary described it, biological war. People's eyes will melt. People's hands will come out of their socket. That's not conventional war. We're talking chemical and biological and nuclear and who knows what else. And the Torah say, Ben she'orel le'tarbut ra'ah, a boy that goes off the derech to a bad culture, to a bad direction, is worse than Gog u'Magog. Maybe it's an exaggeration, of course. The reason that the Gemara used such a language, extreme language, is to make us understand, hey, that's not just a little problem. That's a huge problem, Habibi. I have a woman from LA. Every time I go, she always comes. And she's always the first one. Always. She has 2 or 3 kids. You have to see how she cries every day that they are not religious. Because by the time she found me, she was already in her 60s. She didn't know that much. She put them in public school. They all became business people. I think one married Goya. Mamash like Goyim. I don't want to hear about religion. You have to see how she suffered. You have to see. She's mamash holding her crying every time I come. How are you? Mamash is trying not to cry. But it's not only when she sees me. It's every day for years. She cries non-stop and suffers that her children are like goyim. And she blames herself. Some people don't even care. You become religious and you don't care? Doesn't kill you to see your son married to goya and his children are goyim? It doesn't bother you? What are you made from? Huh? What are you made from? If his son's going to need a kidney, he won't sleep 2 months. Wow, my son needs a kidney. He doesn't feel good. You worry about his kidney? He has another kidney. Don't worry. Worry about his neshama that is already destroyed for eternity. If he dies the way he is right now. For that you have to worry. Parents that don't cry every day to Hashem that the children will become Baalei Tshuva, either they are brainless or they're heartless. One of the two. Or both. There's no words to describe such parents. Or maybe they're just selfish. They only care about themselves. They don't care about anyone else. How can it not bother you like this? How? That you see that this kid that you brought to the world will end in a worse place when he dies. And you know what? You don't worry about his neshama. Worry about your neshama. He's there because of you. Because you're cheap. You didn't want to spend $700-$800 a month to put him in yeshiva. So you send him to public school with all the gangsters, with the Puerto Rican gang over there. He grew up with them. That's why he's full of tattoos. That's why he speaks like them. That's why he has a gun in his car and a baseball bat. That's why when he talks, you can never believe he's a Jew. Because you're trying to save $10,000 a year when you made millions. You made millions in Manhattan selling gold and diamonds and try to save $10,000 a year sending your kids to public school here in Forest Hills. Every day did not get killed over there. It's a miracle. With all the bullies and what's going on over there. and now he became a goy, and he will marry a goya. And all you care about is making more money. That's what's going on today. I read to you the verse. Im chatata, if you commit a sin, matif albo. What did you do to Hashem? Verabu psha'echa mataselo. Your crimes becoming higher and higher, more and more. What did you do to Hashem? It's still perfect. Im tzadakta, if you are a tzadik, you became righteous. Mati tenlo. What did he get? He's still perfect. He's always perfect. When you go down and when you go up, you do not affect him. Omami atchaikach. What would he need from you? What, he needs something from you? He's sick. He doesn't feel good. He needs you to give him Advil or something. What does he need from you? Leish kamoch harishecha. Your wickedness, your bad actions goes to you. Uleven adam tzidkatcha. If you do good, it's for you. If you do bad, it's for yourself. You're not doing me a favor. If you're smart, you listen to me that I'm going to pay you what you deserve. You're stupid, you ignore me. And then you're going to get what you deserve. I don't need you. I was perfect without you. I will be perfect after you. I'm perfect when you become a goy. I'm perfect when you become a rabbi. You won't improve me, you won't upgrade me, and you won't downgrade me. Like some foolish people think that Hashem needs us. What did Hashem do for billions of years before he made the world? I was in a pretty good mood. He didn't need Itzik and Avi and Boris to put tefillin. Why did he make the world? To benefit us. Put us here, earn, I'll give you, earn. You should know one more thing. The mitzvot is not only to earn. The mitzvot is to make your life more decent. It makes you a better person. When you live in a system, you live in a system. So what happened? If you have limitations, allowed, not allowed, then you begin to have control on your traits, on your desires, on what comes out of your mouth. The Torah is a beautiful training system to make you from an animal into a human being. Because every person that is not connected to the Torah is 100% an animal. Jews and non-Jews. 100%. Animals scream and bark and fight. People do that. Animals run after food and desire. People do that. Animals run after sexual activity. People do that. Animals wants to grab and think and hide and save for later. People do that. Animals like to swim and jump into the water. People do that. What is the difference between us and the animals? The only way to come out of your animal status and to become an angel is the Torah. That's it. The Torah gives you disciplines. With no disciplines, you can't even wake up in the morning. Most people don't even wake up in the morning. The only time they wake up in the morning is if they have greed. They love money more than they love to sleep. So the money and the business that they have and the money-making machine that they have force them to wake up, not because it's the right thing to do. What's the proof? On Sunday they sleep until 11. The days that they don't work, weekend, they sleep. There's no meaning to their life besides running after money. A person that has connection to Hashem, working, not working, he wakes up in the morning. Why? I start my day with filah, with connection to Hashem. Even if I'm off, 1 week off now, still wake up. Even if it's hard. The last 3-4 days, all together, maybe I slept 6 hours. The last 2 hours a night. There's no time to sleep. In a seminar, Sunday night, I finished the lecture around 11:30. Last night, I had in Los Angeles a lecture. More than 100 people stayed outside in the rain. It was rain. 3 days of rain. I was supposed to have a big event in Beverly Hills, outdoor. But it started to rain all day, the day before and the day of the lecture. So in the last minute, we had to move it to an alternative place. Pretty big place. But how many people can fit in a house? 100, 120, that's it. The rest all stayed outside. And at night in LA, it's really cold. It gets very cold there at night. It's not Florida. Florida, it's all the time hot. Over there, it really gets cold at night. I cannot believe I saw people sitting in the rain outside, in the rain, for 2 hours. Rain is dripping on your head, not to miss the shiur. But then my guy told me, at least 100 people came. They couldn't come in, they left. Chaval. There was no time to sleep. By the time I got home, it was 12-something. So many emails and messages. And we have to get up for the nets. Bathroom, shower, sending the lectures to my guy to post them on the online. Takes hours. Mamash, an hour and a half, and right away nets. And from the nets, right away to the airport. And the flight, I landed an hour before the shiur. Come here, finish here, go home, sending the thing to the guy. A few hours later, you're in shul already. Why? You have a system. It's very difficult to have disciplines without the Torah. And don't tell me the army is also discipline. I was in the army, I know. The army is illusional disciplines. If you're not going to wake up, they put you in jail. So you must wake up. They tell you, you have 7 minutes to be on the truck. It's not going to repeat it. You're not going to make it to the truck. You sit 3 weeks in jail. Of course you get up. Thank you very much. You agree to wake up at 5, 6 in the morning. You're not going to wake up. You suffer for 3 weeks. You clean the bathrooms. So you wake up. But the Torah, you can sleep until 11. You miss Kriyat Shema. You miss davening. Nobody puts gun to your head. You don't go to jail. So when you wake up, that's discipline. Without a gun to your head. Why? Because you learn that. That's what Hashem likes. The first halacha in Shulchan Aruch is what? Get up like a tiger. Itgaber ka'ari la'avodat ha'abore. If really we think about it, what do we gain from the minute the alarm goes off for staying 10 more minutes in bed? What do we gain? Such yetzer hara. Anyway, you're going to be the same tired. If you get up now or in 10 minutes, you're still the same tired. If you slept 4 hours, 5, 6, that 10 minutes will change anything. But what is the risk that you say 5 more minutes and you fall asleep and you miss your flight? Or you come 1 hour late to work? Or you miss the minyan? That's what happened. So Hashem is perfect with or without you. And the Gemara say, what does Hashem care where you're going to slaughter the animal from? Does he care? He's going to be here or here or there. Does it make a difference for Hashem if you slaughter from the front or if you slaughter from the back? Does it even make a difference for him? He needed to make a system here of a test. Okay, so let's make rules. What is the difference between Rosh Chodesh to Mitzvat Brit Milah and Gida Nasheh? Why the Gemara ignored those two mitzvot and they said that this mitzvah was the first one that the nation of Israel got? The Chachamim knows more Torah than us. And we also know that they got Brit Milah and Gida Nasheh before. But the Chachamim said, this mitzvah should have been the first pasuk in the Torah. Achodesh hazeh lachem rosh chodashim. Why? Because that was the first mitzvah that the nation of Israel got. What are the Chachamim are saying? What are they saying? The answer is, Brit Milah was given to each individual and individual. You don't have kids, you don't have to do it. You have only girls, you don't have to do it. Gida Nashe, you want to slaughter a cow, you're going to have this mitzvah. You don't want to eat meat, you don't have it. It's not an obligation. It's a conditional mitzvah. If you will have children, boys, you will need Brit Milah. If you want to eat, slaughter a cow, you're going to have to be careful not to eat Gida Nashe. Okay. You can ignore these two mitzvot. You can live all your life. You have only girls. You never do Brit Milah. Not everyone had this chut. But this is a general mitzvah for the entire Jewish nation. For every Jew and Jew. It's not a conditional mitzvah. That's why this mitzvah is very special. Time is running out. Let's get some idea for the time that we have left. Some more things about the parasha. Hashem is obviously sending Moshe to Paro and preparing him for what's coming. I'm going to make his heart stiff. The whole purpose of this show is to make a mockery out of Egypt. I will bring them down on their knees for the future generations to know what happened here. Why every time they came to Paro, they say, tomorrow Hashem is doing such and such. Why they came a day before? Why not today? You have 2 hours, ultimatum. Why always tomorrow? Tomorrow Hashem is going to do such and such. Why? The answer, to give him enough time to fight with his evil inclination and to do the right thing. Sometimes 2-3 hours is not enough. And not only that, Moshe also described to them what's going to happen. For instance, when the grasshoppers, Moshe said, you won't see the sun. Grasshoppers, it makes everything black. You know, they come in billions. They block the light. Yeah, you ever saw that? In Egypt, they had a few years ago, a video. They come, billions of them. You look up, you don't see the sun. It become all dark. It's unbelievable how they all fly together. They block the sun. Moshe said to them, they will block the sun completely. They'll eat all the plants, all the trees that still survive from the hail. And what grew again on the trees after the hail. They will enter the houses. They will bite people. Even normally grasshoppers don't bite people. These grasshoppers will bite people. You're going to feel every second. Imagine this, biting all over you. They'll bite you. Moshe see all the advisor of Paro, they getting very nervous. He went out. Let me give you time to think. He went up. The advisor said to Paro, this man is destroying us. You should send the Jewish nation that Egypt won't be destroyed. Paro right away sent a messenger to Moshe and Aaron. Okay, I agree. I agree that you go. Go and sacrifice to Hashem in the desert. Who is going? Moshe said, everyone. The adults, the young, the boy, the girls, the cattle. Paro gets angry. If you want to sacrifice, why you need to take the kids? Leave the kids here, collateral. Ah, you bunch of snakes. Ah, you bunch of crooks. You're telling me you're going only to sacrifice and you come back, huh? That's why you want to take the kids, because you want to escape. I'll just caught your plan. You want to run away. Who got up and kicked them out of the palace? Who? Who was the main advisor of Paro? Bilam. Get out of here, you croaks. Bilam, send them away. Then what? Hashem said to Moshe, raise your hand with a cane towards the direction of Egypt. And strong wind would come from the east all day and all night. Billions of grasshoppers came. Just like Moshe said. They blocked the wells. Nobody can go into the wells to get water. They beat. They sting them. They ate their eyes. Egyptian came out with no pupils. What happened? He beat me in my eye. Many of them lost their eyes. But they ate mainly all the plants and all the trees. Everything became brown. There's no green anymore. Now one leaf left in Egypt, the Torah say. Now one leaf in the whole land of Egypt. Paro ran urgently to call Moshe and Aaron. Chatati le'Hashem. I sinned to Hashem and to you. Pray to Hashem to take this death away from us. Moshe prayed. Hashem turned the direction of the grasshoppers into the ocean. They all fell into the Red Sea. Not even one of them left in Egypt. Even the ones that the Egyptian locked. The Egyptian locked them because people used to eat them, you know. The Yemenite, they eat grasshoppers. They fry them in a pan. I asked one Temani, how can you eat such a thing? Tell me, it actually tastes like French fries. French fries? Yeah, you fry them in a pan. Ugh, just from thinking about it, I want to faint. Not all of them are kosher. That's the whole point. You and me cannot eat grasshoppers. Persians cannot eat it. Bukharians cannot eat it. Syrians cannot eat it. Ashkenazim cannot eat it. The only ones can eat it today, it's the Yemenites. Do you know why? Because they are the only one who have tradition from generation to generation how to check which one of them are kosher and you can eat or not. Because they are the only one who are so poor that there was nothing to eat, so they ate grasshoppers. In Europe, the Jews over there don't eat grasshoppers. They eat lamb, steaks, lax, gefilte fish. You understand? In the Arab countries, steak, ashpolo, gujguje, gondi. With the Baruch Hashem, we did not need. Look at the food of the Yemenite. All their food is water and flour. Everything. Fatut, malawach, jachnun, kubana. Everything. Water and flour. Nothing to eat. Such a poor country, this Yemen. So they ate grasshoppers was a treat. Treat. What bracha you make on grasshoppers? Huh? Shakol. Is it besari or no? Huh? Is this considered meat or no? Grasshoppers. Chicken considered meat or no? Chicken really is not meat, but the Chachamim made a decree that it counts like a meat. That's why you cannot eat chicken and dairy. You cannot have chicken with the melted cheese on it. But if you do, what kind of sin you're breaking? Rabbinical, Rabbanan. You eat meat with cheese, that's already the oraita, if they're hot. But if you eat chicken, it's rabbinical. Grasshoppers, it's considered like chicken or considered like meat? Huh? It's not besari. You can eat it with dairy. Why? How do I know? No, let's see if you're clever. How do I know that the Temanim, the Yemenites, that until today they eat grasshoppers, a minute later they can eat pizza? Huh? It doesn't have split hooves. And it's not Ma'ale Gera. It's not an animal. It's not, I mean, a meat. It's not a cow. It's not a sheep. Zenoma Fris Parsa Ma'ale Gera. And so maybe you say, but maybe it's like chicken. Maybe there's decree on it. We never saw that there's decree not to eat grasshoppers with dairy. There's decree not to eat chicken with dairy. That's from the time of the Gemara. Of bechalav, you can't eat. What about fish and milk? Bagel with lox and cream cheese? Allowed or not allowed? Ashkenazim, they live on it every morning. Breakfast, bagel with lox and cream cheese. Sfaradim don't eat it. I heard that some Syrians do eat it. The reason we don't eat it is Sfaradim because it's written in Sfarim that it's not healthy. Sakana. Chamira sakanta miisura. It's not healthy. So one person asks, wait, so for the Sfaradim it's not healthy, but for the Ashkenazim it's healthy? Huh? What do you think? Can you eat something that it's healthy for you and it's not healthy for your brother? What do you think? Of course. How many things in life you eat, it's wonderful minerals for you. Your brother is allergic. Huh? I know one guy used to help me in a website 10 years ago. Everything he was eating, he checked 10 times if he doesn't have eggs in it. So what? Mayonnaise, he can eat. This, he cannot eat. Egg. Why? So if you see me eating egg, in less than a minute, my face will become like a watermelon. It's allergic. So I eat eggs, good for me, makes me full, has some all kinds of vitamins in it, whatever. He'll eat it, he can die. Same food can affect one and not affect the other. But really the answer is, because the halacha of the Sfaradim is like that, it's sakana. Before the rabbis of the Ashkenazim allow it, Hashem does that it's not going to be sakana. Remember what the Torah says. Everything that happened to you in your life, everything, Hashem sent it to you. And why? Because you brought it on yourself. And remember, it's not only secular people that deny it. A lot of religious people think that everything that happens to them is bad luck, random, coincidence. I was in the wrong place in the wrong time, Rabbi. Baloney. You were there because Hashem wanted you to be there. And your friend did not go there because Hashem didn't want him to get hurt. That's all. And why you got hurt, now it's a whole list of possibility. Maybe because of Michalel Shabbat. It's a very big crime. That penalty in the Torah, it's not a joke. Torah says Michalel Shabbat mot yumat. Maybe because you're making sins with all kinds of women. Maybe you're married to a non-Jewish woman. Every second to be next to her, it's a sin. Every time you touch her hand, it's a very big sin. Every time you're intimately with her, it's a huge sin. In the next world, it's going to be the biggest embarrassment for you for eternity. It's no joke. Some people think, I'm doing it for 10 years and everything is fine. She takes care of me, she's great, she's better than all the Jewish girlfriends I had. Yes. You're not lying. But when you're going to get the bill, you're going to see what the Torah meant. Smile. In Israel, they ever say, Ma, tzochek mi shetzochek acharon. You can laugh now as much as you want. It doesn't matter who laughs now. It matters who will be laughing after the soul will leave the body and will come to a trial in front of Hashem. Mishpat Yud Bet Chodesh, 12 months. That's why we say Kaddish for 1 year. What do you think? It's a joke? You marry a non-Jewish woman, your kids are not Jewish. They're not Jewish. They're not your children. You go in the next world to another place and they go to a different place. Yesterday I had in my lecture in LA a guy like this. They told me in advance. How about these two guys? He has this problem and this guy is living. He just got married to a Muslim Goya, he said to me. And he's going to probably ask you about it in a lecture. And he did. And you can see it online tomorrow night. You can see it. I told him the truth in his face. What do you think he did? Got up and left, angry. Who is he angry at? Maybe at me. Maybe at Hashem. That's it. Who is he angry at? But he's not angry at himself. No. He's not angry at himself that he made such a mistake and destroyed his life. It takes away the blessing. It makes you lose money. It makes you die younger. It makes your body smell. It makes you lose your hair. You have to see the list of curses that come when a person lives with a non-Jewish woman. And not because she's not good. She's much better than him. The goyim are less wicked than us because they only have to keep 7 laws. So if they don't keep the 7 laws, they break only 7 laws. We have much more laws to keep. If we don't keep, we are bigger criminals than them. If I have to come to work 2 hours a day and I cheat my boss, so I cheat him by 2 hours. If somebody else has to come to work 10 hours, he's cheating him by 10 hours. Who is a bigger crook? Someone that cheat 2 hours or someone that cheat 10 hours? Everybody understand who? If a Jew has to keep Shabbat and he doesn't, he's a big criminal. If a Goy doesn't keep Shabbat, he's not a criminal, doesn't have to keep Shabbat. He's not allowed to keep Shabbat. A Goy that keeps Shabbat will get punishment for that. It's not allowed. It's a gift that Hashem gave to the Jewish people. It's written. That's what we say in the Kiddush. V'shamru b'nei Israel et ha-Shabbat. The nation of Israel observed the Sabbath. La'asot et ha-Shabbat ledorotam brit olam. To make Shabbat for their generations an eternal covenant. Beni uven bnei Israel ot I leolam. Between me and the nation of Israel, it's a sign for eternity. A sign for what? Ki sheshet yamim asa Hashem et ha-shamayim v'et ha-aretz. That Hashem created heaven and earth and everything in it in 6 days. And in a 7 day, he rested. He did not create anything on a 7 day. And what does it say right after that? Mechaleleha mot yumat. Someone that makes Shabbat a weekday will die younger in this life. Supposed to live to 90, will die 75. Supposed to live to 80, will die 65. Supposed to die, to live 110, will die 90. Will lose years of his life for sure. But that's not the punishment. That's nothing. You live another 10 years, less 10 years. That's not the critical part. Mot, yumat. The Torah say, what does it mean, this duplication? Will die twice? Can you die twice? You died already. Mot, why yumat? Again, later. Mot, in this world, the Torah say, yumat for the eternal life. Billions of years of suffering. People think the Torah is a joke. They look at it as tradition. Hobby. Fanatic rabbis making up primitive rules. Someone that is smart, come challenge the rabbi. Come to me, come. Here, it's in front of a video. Bring me all this atheist professor. Bring me. I had this Persian clothing designer, Barami. Someone told me he brainwashed the brain of a lot of professional Persians in Great Neck. Why? Well, he's rich, famous. People think he's smart. And he keeps bringing doubts into their mind about the religion. One person told me, I want you to debate him. So of course, bring him over. We made a debate on Fifth Avenue in Manhattan. You can see it on the DVD, it's online. It had many, many views on YouTube. 3 hours debate. He brought an assistant, a doctor or a pharmacist. He brought another Persian guy to help him. In the middle of the debate, his assistant got up. You can see it, I'm not lying to you. You can go and check. He got up in front of the camera and the audience, and he told him, the rabbi destroyed you, enough. His assistant. I did not destroy him, the Torah destroyed him. After 3 hours, he said, I'm an atheist. When we finished the debate, he said, come, Rabbi, let me give you a blessing. I'm a Kohen. Yevarechecha Hashem veishmerecha, you fool. 3 hours he's standing here and said there's no God. The Torah is nothing. How Hashem fooled him. In the end of the debate, in front of the camera, he gives me Birkat Kohanim. You understand what does it mean to be secular? 99% of what you say, it's baloney. You yourself know it's baloney. You claim the Torah is not from God? Come to me in 3 minutes, I prove it to you. Prove! Not you have to believe. We're not Christians. Christian, it's all believing, believing. The Torah doesn't say to believe. If you're believing, you are nothing. The Torah says you should know I'm your God. You should know I'm watching you. You should know everything you have I gave you. Houses that you did not build. Food that you did not plant. Wells that you did not dig. Gold, silver, animals. Back in time. Today it's cars, jewelry, other things. Eat, enjoy, be full, be happy, but don't be ungrateful. Say thank you. What's the big deal? 2 minutes to say a blessing? Most blessing is 10 seconds. Only Birkat Hamazon take 2-3 minutes. That's it. How many times do you eat bread? Once a day, let's say. 2 minutes a day you don't want to give me? 24 hours a day I give you oxygen. I make your brain function. Your stomach digests the food. Your body cleans the waste. You're able to walk. You enjoy. You enjoy the food. You have children. You have so many things I gave you. What do you do with what I give you? Money, success. You take it, you never say thank you, and you use it against me every second of your life. If someone come to me and say, I'm not going to be religious. I'm not religious. Why are you not religious? Because I don't believe the religion is from God. I think you, the stupid rabbi, has made it up. I admire him. Much more than someone who say, I'm traditional. My parents in Iran were religious. My grandfather was a rabbi. I know, I believe. Rabbi, don't look at me. I'm not a goy. I believe. You are worse than this guy. Because you know it's true, and you spit in the face of your Creator every second of your life. He doesn't believe in him. He doesn't believe the Torah is from him. So what's the solution? You sit an hour with him, and you show him that the Torah can never be written by a human being. Not possible. Not possible. It's full of prophecies. It's full of knowledge of the nature, knowledge of the oceans, knowledge of the galaxies, the renewal of the moon to 6 digits after the decimal point, when there was no calculator back then, no computer, no telescope. Watch my film, Torah and Science. It will answer you everything. Once you see that the Torah can never be written by a human being, only the creator of the world was able to write it, now he's going to change. Because why he did not keep? Because he didn't think it's from God. Why should he die? If someone gives me a piece of book, I don't know, out of Zimbabwe. Here, follow it, it's good for you. It's the God of the people of Zimbabwe. I don't believe in it. I take it and put it in the garbage. But if he proves to me that it's real, then if I put it in the garbage, I'm the biggest criminal in history. And half of my nations are like this. Half of them. Most Jews, you tell them, step on the Torah. Here, let's open it on the floor. Come, step on the Torah, I give you $1,000 cash. With your shoes, walk on the ladders. You crazy, Rabbi? What am I looking to you, a monster? Why, what's there? For you, it's a toilet paper, no? You ignore it like you ignore a toilet paper. You never follow it. You make fun of it every second of your life. You contradict it every second of your life. Not once in your life you gave it a second of respect. Step on it! Step! You kill me, I won't step on it. I won't. Why? Why this hypocrisy? If you ignore it and it's nothing for you, step on it. Be honest, be real. If you say, I don't believe in it, it's a piece of paper for me, step on it. Because if you put toilet paper on the floor and tell me, step on it, I'll step on it. No problem. You don't want to step on it? Do you know why? Because you know that it's a holy document. So why are you ignoring it? Why? It's written over here that in the end, Sof davar akol nishma. Sof davar akol nishma. In the end, everything will be heard. Et ha'elokim yera, fear God, ve'et mitzvotav shmor, and keep his commandment, ki ze kol ha'adam. That's what the human being is all about. That's the only reason you came to the world. Not to swim in a swimming pool in Beverly Hills. That's not what you came to the world for. You like it? Fine. I'm not going to kill you for that. I'm not upset at you. Enjoy. Build a nice house. Drive a nice car. No problem. But don't be a criminal. Don't be a thief. Don't be mechalel Shabbat. Marry a Jewish woman. Keep taharat mishpacha. Be all, do what the Torah say. Give tzedakah. Be a decent human being. Say thank you. Come to shul, pray, put tefillin. What's the big deal? 2-3 hours a day you have to invest for your soul? 20 hours a day you invest in your body with your addictions and your nonsense. 2-3 hours a day you don't want to give to the soul? You know how many secular people started to cry non-stop for the first time in their life when they started to read Tehillim? They couldn't hold their tears. If they understand Hebrew, they read the words, it's very, very touchy. It's very hard not to cry. You read the Tehillim, David HaMelech wrote it 3,000 years ago. The words over there, it's mamash opening the heart. After the Torah, the most important Jewish document is Tehillim. A lot of halachot come from there. Gemara, a lot of parts of the Gemara is on the verses of Tehillim. Rabotai, before we finish, we have 10 minutes to the end of this lecture. I'm telling you what I said to you an hour and a half ago, for those who came late. I work with the public for 24 years. Baruch Hashem, Hashem helped me. Every year I made thousands of Baalei Tshuva. Multiplied by 24 years, probably 150 to 200,000 people in the world. That are Shomer Shabbat, Shomer Mitzvot, a lot of people. But I'm going to tell you right now, after 24 years of work, non-stop work with the public, and millions of listeners on the website, on the Facebook, 250,000 fans on the Facebook pages, so many millions of views on the videos. The situation today is the worst it's ever been. There never ever been so much suffering and sicknesses and problems in a Jewish nation ever than now, ever. Every 20 minutes, I get a new cancer situation into my phone. Every 20 minutes. From different parts of the world. Israel, America, New York, Los Angeles. All over. It's not only old people. A lot of young people get cancer. People who just got married have only one baby, already cancer. Things that never seen before. I have a friend who's a doctor. He told me, I'm a doctor for almost 20 years. When I started, and now, nothing to compare. It became an epidemic. There's real anger at us from Hashem. Remember what the Torah says. If I'm sending you a sickness and you dare to say it's nature, immediately I send you another one. It's written in Parashat B'chukotai. Don't dare to say coincidence. Because it's written in the Torah, כל המחלה אשר שמתי במצרים לא אשים עליך כי אני השם רופאך. All the sicknesses that I brought to the land of Egypt, I will not put on you because I am your God, I am your doctor. I am the one who gives the sickness and I'm the only one who can take it away. I use the doctors, I use equipment, I use the hospital, I use the ambulance, yes. I use a lot of people to do what I want them to do. Hashem has a lot of messengers that he uses, of course. Final decision, it's 100% Hashem. If you live or you die, it's Him. You'll be sick, it's Him. You get cured, it's Him. But He doesn't make decision randomly. He doesn't have a Russian roulette that He turns and see what number comes out. And based on that, He makes His decision. No. Please don't be stupid to think like this. The decisions are 100% honest and precise. You make repentance, I have more reasons to take it out. You continue with your crimes, why should I take it out? Why should I? You continue to steal, I'm going to give you a blessing. You continue to charge interest from Jews, I'm going to give you a blessing. You continue to torture your wife. How many people lost all their money just because they tortured their wives? Do you know? The Torah says, you want to be rich, make sure your wife is happy. Even if she's not the nicest person in the world. Not every wife is great. Some are good, some are not. Like everyone else. Husbands, some are good, some are not. The Torah says, I'm giving you a tip. You want to be rich? Make sure your wife does not sit home and cry. If she sits home and cries, you will never have blessing in your life. Never, no matter how brilliant you are. And I see people that really make millions. I see, they come, they talk to me. I make over $1 million a year. And I'm in debt up to here. Why? How can it be? I invested in real estate here and over there. They give me permit. The neighbors sue me. This, that. Wow. Non-stop. No blessing. I know someone has a building that worth $200 million. Their rent over there is more than $100,000 a month. At least 10 times in the last 20 years he came to me to ask me for a loan. I don't have 1% of 1% of what he has. Can you lend me a few thousand? I don't get it. You're making so much money every month. What happened? He begin to tell me how the money is gone. This, that. Wow, cannot believe. He went and bought a brand new SUV. Brand new. He said, tomorrow I'll take care of the insurance. $45,000. Put it in his driveway. Get up in the morning. Was stolen. No insurance. Things like this. He makes. But there's no blessing. No blessing. Make it here, lose it there. Make it here, lose it there. We have avrechim in yeshiva make a few $100 a month. You have to see how they survive. For every dollar, there's blessing in it. They survive. It doesn't make sense. The last 5 minutes, let's get really into the situation that was in Egypt before, moments before they came out. Hashem comes to the Jewish people and say, now it's the test to test your faith, your emunah. Now it's the test. What is the test? I want you now to go to the markets of the Egyptian and buy all the goats. The goats was the god of the Egyptians. They bow down to the goats, like the Indians bow down to the cow. The Egyptians would ask you, why are you buying all these goats? In 4 days we're going to slaughter them and make them shish kebab. We're going to make shish kebab. What do you mean? Bukharian wedding. Kebab, steak, lamb chops, 7 floors of food. Don't worry. Now imagine this. The Egyptian is going crazy. Go and tell Indian in India, give me this cow, I want to buy it. Why? Why are you buying it? I want to make some steaks for my children. You have to see what's going to happen to you. If a cow stands in the middle of the highway for 3 hours, nobody pushes it. They wait. You don't disturb God. That's how they are. Now I tell you, I want to ask you a question. Imagine you come to the Muslims, you live in a Muslim country, Syria, Iran, I don't know. You come to the Muslim, you go up to their mosque, they have a symbol of a moon, you know half a moon? You go like this, you're breaking it. What are you doing? Yahud, I'm taking it out. Why? In 4 days I make a big fire and we'll burn it. What will happen to all the Jews in Iran if one Jew will do something like this? Or two? Or in Syria? Or in Iraq? Or any other country? What will happen to the Jews? Riots! Million fanatic Muslims will come and burn every place, the synagogues and everything. Right or wrong? What guts you have to go to the Egyptians after you were slaves there for more than 80 years working like in Auschwitz, in their face, give me all the goats you have. Why? I make a party, I slaughter it. And don't worry, they won't touch you. Trust me. Now I want to ask you a question. The mitzvah of Korban Pesach, the sacrifice of Passover, you must eat it roasted. If you cook it in a kettle or steamed it, you broke the law. That's not kosher. You're not allowed. It must be roasted shish kebab. Why? What does Hashem care how I eat it? Now, I don't like it roasted. I like it cooked and fried in a pan. What do you care how I cook it? Why Hashem say you must roast it? Why? Let's see who's clever here. Why does he care? Why does he care? The answer is, Rabotai, because when you make shish kebab, what happened to the whole area? 2 or 3 miles away. The smoke goes everywhere. And everyone in Egypt smelled their God is being burned. If you fry it in a pan, nobody smell anything. You steam it in your house, nobody smell. Go over there in Main Street, how the restaurants spread smoke all over from their chimneys. Why? Better than any advertisement. You just walk in Main Street, in Jewel area. Wow, this is a good shawarma now. Right away, like a magnet. The smell makes you millions a year, the smell of the meat. Right or wrong? The Torah says, Reach Nichoach, it's the greatest smell of food. Barbecue. I want you to roast it, and the neighbor, the Egyptian, will look, and his eyes is coming out, and he see how you abuse his God, and he won't make a beep. And minutes after that, you come out of Egypt. Huh? No, it's only after they used it as an idol, you're not allowed. They used it in a ceremony. You understand or no? I give you an example. The goyim bow down to the moon and to the sun. You're allowed to enjoy the sun? The Gemara asked this question. Because the stupid goyim bow down to the sun, so now I'm going to die from freezing weather because I don't want to enjoy the heat of the sun? So, but if a goy takes something and uses it for his idol, sacrifice, or makes it an idol, puts it here, then this was mamash used for Avodah Zarah, then we can use it. That's why there's a lot of noise about the wigs. That religious women put wigs, and the hair is, almost all the hair comes out of India. And this hair is women shave the hair and sacrifice it to their idols. It's tikrovet Avodah Zarah, it's a very big problem. A lot of religious women put on their head something that the goyim in India were sacrificing to these big idols. It's against the Torah. That's why a lot of rabbis scream about it. It's a whole big problem of this Avodah Zarah. Shem Yazor, if they get hair from Europe, let's say, that European women just shave, and if there was a possible to do such thing, okay, so that at least there's no Avodah Zarah. As long as the wig is modest, and there's no avodah zara, some rabbis allow it. Problem today that many people that checked claim that almost all the air comes from India, because the Indian women have the most thick and healthy air, and it's easy to diet and to put it in a wig. Shem Yatzilenu, a religious woman, she loves Hashem, she keeps mitzvot. Especially the Ashkenazim, they all use wigs, almost all of them. And they use this pe'ah, and she has no idea that this hair a year ago was in front of a big idol in India, and there's movies about it. I don't know if you saw that video, how they bring the hair to their gods and how they bow down, because they're so poor, they have nothing else to bring. Why they shave their hair and bring it? They don't have anything. Do you know that millions of people in India live on the sidewalk with rats like this? Mattress on a sidewalk. Mattress is black like mud because it rains on it, and the rats goes on it, and all kinds of dirt, and they sleep like this on the street. They don't even have a tent. They sleep on a sidewalk. Imagine this, you have 5 kids and you sleep on a sidewalk in Queens. Right here on Main Street. What are you doing? I'm living here on a sidewalk. Rats like this, walking on them at night. Cold, hot, rain. That's India. Soon as you come out of the plane and you walk there in those places, Bombay, Mumbai, all these places, hundreds of little Indian kids come. Either they come to pickpocket you, or they come to beg for a dollar. You give them a dollar, this is a month's salary for these kids. Dollar. What do you buy in dollar? What do you buy? $1 in America, can you buy something? Besides 10 chicken nuggets from Burger King, that it's all bread basically, and there's really no chicken there. What can you buy for a dollar today? Basically nothing. Even a bottle of water costs $2. No? Come to store, bottle of water. Huh? Still $1? Wow. The recession kicked in. The market crashed. They're bringing the prices down. Get ready for very hard year. 2019 will be very hard year. Real estate will go down. The market would crash. Will be a lot of bad things happening. If you invest in real estate, be careful. If you can sell now, as much as you can sell, better. Because it's going to be like 2008 and maybe even more. It's going to be a big problem. Not only here, in the whole world. In Israel also, it's going to be a big problem. It's already kicking in, the recession. Very big problems right now. Hashem Yazor, it will never be paradise forever. There was a few good years. People made a lot of money. Now, Hashem Yirachem, what's going to happen? The government is on strike. People don't get their salary. The president is stubborn. He's saying, as far as I'm concerned, it can be years like this. Until the liberal traders will not surrender and allow me to build a wall, I'll put this entire country on a strike. That's maybe the only way they understand. Because if he will surrender to them, it's the end of us. With their ideology, they bring a disaster to the country. All these Democrats and Shem Yirachem. We'll see. We'll talk about it in another time. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen. Rabbi